Naomi watched this all the time, and Pastor Vince sometimes, about The Voice. Anybody ever heard about The Voice, the show?
Yeah.
About The Voice, how The Voice, and they're singing, and, you know, they're showing their talents, and different things like that, right? So my message tonight is the voice, knowing the voice, or being that voice, amen. But John the Baptist, in Matthew chapter 3, let's turn there, and we'll go ahead and pray in a minute. But I really wanted to share with the other young people that are here. There's just two back there, and they'll come back up so we can pray for them. Like Pastor Vince said, hold your Bibles to Matthew chapter 3, and I want you to go to Deuteronomy 13, verse 19. Deuteronomy chapter 30, and I'm going to start with this, with my scripture that I used first. You guys stay on Deuteronomy chapter 3, Deuteronomy chapter 30, and I'm going to start on mine with Matthew chapter 3, because, and it said, let me pray. Father, we thank you for this time. We ask you to bless your word, Lord God, as it goes forth, Lord God. Just give me the words to say, Lord God, and let it be with clarity. And thank you for Holy Spirit for speaking through me, and Father God, using me. And I thank you that you're an awesome God. We pray that our ears would be open and our hearts would be ready to receive what you have for us tonight. In the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. In those days, John the Baptist appeared preaching in the wilderness of Judea along the western side of the Dead Sea and saying, repent. Change your inner self, your old ways of thinking, regret past sins, live your life in a way that proves repentance, seek God's purpose for your life. And this is the Amplified Bible, wow. For the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Amen. This is the one who was mentioned by the prophet Isaiah when he said, the voice of one shouting in the wilderness, prepare the road for the Lord. Make his highways straight, level, direct. And see, John was a man that was preaching in the wilderness, and his voice went throughout the whole region of Judea. Everywhere he went, they were hearing his voice. Amen? And how many know that I want to leave a legacy that people hear my voice, and they don't hear me complaining, come on now, and they don't hear me with negativity, but they hear me preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes. Me telling them to repent, to change their inner self, your old ways of thinking, regret past sins, live a life in a way that proves repentance, seek God's purpose for your life, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. I want the people to know my voice in that way. They knew John the Baptist's voice, and they were getting pretty tired of John the Baptist, because every time they went out there, every time that the king went out there, he would tell them to repent for their sins, because people were living in sin in those days, along with these days. They live in sin, they do what they want, right? And we need a voice tonight that's going to cry out and shout in the highways and the byways. We need a voice that's gonna uncompromised voice that's going to shout and that's going to and cry out and tell the people to repent that Jesus Christ is coming back soon. Amen? And God is looking for your voice. And, you know, sometimes we don't want to use our voice. Sometimes we don't want to tell other people, what God has done in our lives, like Pastor Vince was saying, but we got to, because that's our testimony, amen? So the Bible said that he went out into the wilderness and he preached in the wilderness of Judea along the western side of the Dead Sea and saying, amen? So that was his voice, and he was crying in the wilderness, And we need to be that voice that God has called us to do, is to be that voice in the wilderness. Amen? Because Jesus was that voice. Amen? Jesus was that voice, and we are supposed to be that voice in the wilderness, that voice. And talking about the show, the game, but talking about the show on, I don't even know what channel, regular channel, and it's called The Voice, and they're trying to pick who has the best voice. Yeah. And they, I don't know how many contestants, I don't know if it's 30 names?
I don't
know.
No, it's 20.
Who's?
20.
Okay, it's 20. They start with 20?
Yeah.
Okay, they start with 20 and then they narrow it down and they sing different songs and they get the right voice. You know, they want that perfect voice. They want that voice, that unique voice. Come on now. That voice that, you know, that people are going to cry to and people are going to remember, and they're going to do the oohs and the ahs and all this other stuff. You know, they're just looking for that perfect voice. And then the winner gets what? A whole contract, CD, probably thousands and thousands of dollars, because of their voice. And see, we might not get thousands and thousands of dollars, but God wants to use your voice tonight, amen. And let's go to Deuteronomy, and this might not make sense to you, but I want it to make sense. I want it to come together because I want us to be that voice. That maybe we could change somebody's life here tonight. And we could change somebody's life tomorrow at work. Or somebody, we could change somebody's life at school tomorrow, guys. Or we could change somebody's life at, you know, at the grocery store, at Walmart, or at, you know, wherever we go, that we could be that voice. That maybe we could change somebody's destiny and somebody's life. Amen. We might not get a contract, and we might not be the best singers here tonight. Come on now. But we want to be that voice, that unique voice. We want to be that voice that preaches the word of God, the uncompromised word. Not the compromised word, not the one that's wishy-washy, that unique voice God wants. And see, we know we have to know God's voice.
Yeah.
We have to know who God's voice, right?
Yeah.
You have to know, okay, God's voice is, you know, like Pastor Vince was talking about, you know, give to the Lord. You know, that's God's voice. The other voice is, don't give to the church. Keep it for yourself. That's the devil's voice.
Yeah.
Or yourself. I mean, I don't mean to call you devil, but no, I'm just teasing. But seriously, right? But we got to be that voice in that wilderness. And I want to be that voice. And, you know, believe it or not, when I first got saved, I was quiet. I was quiet like a mouse. All you know, you would see me was just go through that hole right there, and that's it. No. I would just come into church and I would be real quiet, right, Pastor Vince? He probably wishes I was like that, you know, somewhat now. But, you know, my voice is a unique voice because, you know, even when I used to pick up my sister, you know, she would probably be debating, you know, is she going to preach to my friends, you know, and I would preach to anybody on the street, and I still will preach to anybody on the street. My voice will go out and tell them, you know what, Jesus, today I passed out flyers and I began to tell this lady about, you know, about God, and began to tell her about our church and stuff. Well, I'll preach anywhere to anybody because I want them to know that God is the answer, and I want to change somebody's life in some way, if I can, all possible. And this story that I'm going to share, and you want to put him up real fast? Okay, let me read this real fast. Don't put him up real fast, because I want to read the Deuteronomy chapter 30. Anybody know what Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 19 says without even looking at it? Or you already got it already? You already got it, sorry. You don't get a candy bar then. Shoot. And I want my voice to go throughout the city of Pueblo, and I want my voice to go out to wherever I go, and I want my voice to be the voice that God is using. Because how many know that? Sure, God could speak, but God wants to use your voice. And you know, when God speaks, guess what happens? All heaven and opens and thunder and light. God's voice is so powerful. So powerful, Oski. God's voice is so amazing and so powerful. Amen? The offer, the title of this, the little verse says, 30 verse 19, but it says the offer of life and death. Now I am commanding you today, it is not too difficult for you or beyond your reach. Verse 12, it is not up in heaven so that you have to ask. We will ascend into heaven to get in, to get it and proclaim it to us so that we may obey it. And verses 19 it says, and this I call the heaven and the earth as witnesses against you, that I have set before you life, and I have set before you death, and I have set before you blessings, and I have set before you cursings. If I was to show you a $100 bill, you know, you would take it versus the dollar bill, no? Right? So God is telling us to choose life or to choose death. He's telling us to choose blessings or he's telling us to choose cursings. Come on now.
Amen.
And the latter of 19, it says, now choose life. He's even telling you what to do. So he's not only giving you an option, okay, choose life or choose death, choose cursings or choose blessings. Who wants cursings? Who wants the little tiny cloud with rain coming down on you everywhere you go? Come on now. Who wants to be cursed and cursed and cursed? Everything you touch withers and dies. Come on now.
Right.
You don't want that, right?
Right?
Jesus, God has told us to choose, set before you. He sets before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Now choose life. And he even told you to choose life. Choose the right path. Choose the narrow path. Don't choose the wide path, because the wide path leads to hell. Choose the narrow path that you can only walk down, you and Jesus alone.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
See, God's voice is powerful. He's telling us, choose life. Yeah. Choose life. That's what God's telling you, kids. That's what us. God's telling us as adults. Choose life. I want you to choose the right way. I want you to be blessed. I don't want you to be cursed. I want you to be blessed. I want you to be blessed in the city and blessed in the fields. Blessed when you're coming in and blessed when you're going out. Come on now.
Amen.
That's what God wants. He doesn't want us to be cursed. And how many of you know what being cursed would be like? Because I know what it would be like, because without Jesus, I was cursed. I had no hope. I had no future. I had no life. Come on now. Some of you guys know it because you guys used to pop pills to get high and be happy and pop pills to go low to go to sleep. Come on now. And that's a cursed life. When you're hooked on drugs and you're hooked on pills and you're an alcoholic, come on now. It was a cursed life. I know. I wasn't ever an alcoholic, but I lived with two alcoholics. And my dad and my stepdad, I lived with two alcoholics. And all it was misery, cops, fighting, arguing, and all this other stuff. It was a cursed life. I lived the life of a person that, you know, that it was just all messed up. I was telling Lexi, I'm trying to teach Lexi and teach the others, you know, people fight. It's all right. Me and Grandpa goes to blows sometimes too, you know. We argue, we disagree, right, Pastor? I mean, there's sometimes, you know, I'm right and he's wrong. And sometimes he's right and I'm wrong. And I was telling him today, I said, do you remember? Let me tell this little story here. Do you remember when we used to fight when we first got saved? And how many know that marriage is awesome and it's good, but it's hard? Come on. And I was telling him, remember when we first got saved, and you know, we couldn't last 2 weeks together when we weren't saved and we weren't together. But when we got saved, Jesus was on our side and we were all excited about the Lord and we just loved the Lord and all that. But when we would fight, I would get all my clothes and I'd say, I'm out of here. I get all my clothes from my closet and I said, I'm out of here. And he laughed at me and he said, well, what would happen with the kids? You would take him and I'd be all free. That's what he said. And I said, I take all five kids and leave him, you know, in the house all comfy, you know. That's what probably he wanted. And how many know that we do crazy stuff that we shouldn't do, but we do, right? You know, we do silly stuff, and we get all mad, and we do stuff. And I was telling him, God has brought us a long way. I was telling the ladies Wednesday, remember when my hair had, I don't know, even know if maybe most of you guys didn't know that, but I was going bald in certain spots. I guess I had something wrong with my thyroid or something. But in certain spots, I was bald, and I thought I was going to die, and I was going to have cancer and all this other stuff. But yeah, it didn't happen. But thank God I'm still here. But right? But we would do crazy stuff, you know, and God has brought us a long way. But you know, we want to be that voice. And you know, God says for us to choose life and not death. You know, He wants us to have a blessed life. And I'm not talking about blessed life like moolah, like millions in the bank. Come on now. I'm talking about blessed from the inside in your spirit and in your heart and your soul and your mind, that you can lay down and have peace. And you know, even though you're arguing with your family or arguing with your kids or there's a problem, you still know that He's the answer.
Amen.
And that everything's going to be all right. And it says, now choose life so that you and your children may live, and that you may love the Lord your God. Listen to His voice. Listen to His voice. Amen. Listen to His voice. That you will love the Lord your God. Love the Lord your God. Listen to His voice. Hold fast to Him. For the Lord is your life, and He will give you many years in the land He swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Amen. And let me go to that picture now. And the reason why I said that, the reason why I'm using this guy, because he really, really, really touched, this story really touched, and I, you know, it burned, it just really, there's two stories, but one story really, I was even preaching it to the kids, and I was looking at it on the news when it happened, and I don't know if it happened a year ago, you know, when he got sentenced or what, but this guy, Aaron Hernandez. And Aaron Hernandez was an NFL football player. And he signed a contract, Oscar, for $40 million. He signed a contract. I'm going to be an NFL player for $40 million. Not $1 million, not $2 million, but $40 million. Not $1,000, not $100, but $40 million. Amen? So Aaron Hernandez made a wrong choice in his life. He didn't choose life, he chose death. And see, this young man made the wrong choices in his life. And I got so hurt. Like, was there somebody preaching to him? Was there somebody, was he listening to the wrong voice? Or, you know, he was listening to the voice of the enemy, and he was drinking and partying, and he thought he was it, and he was an NFL player and making $40 million, signed a contract, and he was a Patriot football player, and you know, on and on and on, and you could go on. And now this young man, as he sits right here, do you got another pictures, Nace?
Yes, I do.
Okay, do you got the pictures where he was got arrested? No?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
There's some up there,
but... Oh, okay, so here he is now. He was an NFL player. He was awesome. He ran fast. He did everything. That's why they signed him. If he wasn't good, they wouldn't have signed him, right?
Yeah.
So here's this guy. And now he's in prison. Now he got arrested because he made the wrong choices in his life. He was hearing the wrong voice, Oscar. He was hearing the wrong voice, Sister Vicky. He was hearing the wrong voice. He was hearing the voice of the enemy telling him, oh, you got it all now. You got all the money in the world. You know, you can go out and party. You can do this and that. And he liked guns. And he went up for, he was charged for murder. And he was convicted of murder. And he will live the rest of his life in prison without parole. This young man. That's heavy duty, right? Do you know what he could have did with the $40 million, Oscar? He could have bought his mom a house. Come on now. You know what he did with his money? He spent all his money, most of it on lawyers, trying to get him out of it because he said he was innocent. Because he stuck around with the wrong crowd. That's his mom crying. Probably visiting him today. Because he'll never get out of prison for the hill. He's going to stay there till the day he dies. Because he made a wrong choice. Because he wasn't listening to God's voice, or he wasn't listening to the right voice. He was listening to the wrong voice. And I was telling my youth Thursday, I said, everything that you do is recorded in school. Everything at school is recorded and written down. So when you're honorary in elementary school, come on now, they write everything down. How many days you missed? How many F's you got? How many N's you got? How many U's you got? Do they still do U's and F's?
Yeah.
How many? So it takes you to the middle school. So when they look, what are they going to see?
Right.
They're going to see your papers. They're going to see your records. Was this young man good? Was this young girl good? How many fights did she get into? How many days did she miss? Come on. So it's very important to make the right choices now, because that education, that folder will go with you till you get to college. If they accept you in Harvard, or if they accept you in any kind of college, they're going to look at those papers. They're going to see what kind of person you were, what kind of choices you made. Oh, school stinks. And I wasn't going to use the other S word, but school stinks. And it's not a bad, well, it's a bad word kind of, but the school stinks. I don't like school and this and that and all that. Well, come on now. We got to make the right choice in life. And the Bible says choose life or death. So what voice do you think he was listening to? Anybody? To the devil himself? He was listening to the wrong voices? To his friends? He loved the party life? Come on now. He liked to be rough and tough? I want to be rough and tough? Come on. And if you're like that when you're little, I can guarantee you're going to be like that if you don't get right. Guarantee. So he made the wrong choice in his life. He chose not. But John the Baptist, on the other hand, he was chosen by God. He was chosen. His parents raised him in the house of God. He was chosen by the Lord.
Amen.
Right? And when he got old, he started to preach the gospel because it was instilled in him. It was in him. He wanted to be that voice crying in the wilderness. But get this, John the Baptist got beheaded. If you know, go back to his story. He died for preaching the gospel. His head was chopped off and placed on a platter in front of a birthday party. Come on now. In front of a birthday party, going prancing around, and he was still preaching when he was in prison. See, John the Baptist was a different story, because John the Baptist went to prison for something good.
Right.
See, Aaron Hernandez went to prison for something he did wrong.
Yeah.
And the devil took his life.
Yes,
he has a chance, kids, to get saved in prison, but he'll never walk out those doors. Never, ever, ever walk out those doors. Ever, ever, ever walk out those doors. So the choices that we make will affect our future. The decisions that we make. Look at his mom. His mom was crying. He's happy there. He's not happy right there. He's happy right there. But he's not happy in the other picture.
Right.
Look at, go back to that. Go back to that. Look at that. Him. Him on the Madden. The Madden. He was on the Madden. On the NCCA football 14, he was on there. Wow. Can you imagine that? Wow, that's amazing. That's $40 million and all the money in the world still. You got to have Jesus.
Amen.
We were talking to this other lady today, and she's like, I'm good, I'm good, I'm all good. Now without Jesus, you nobody's good. I got my life together. My kids need to get together. And on and on. No, you. Remember what you did when those babies were little. The choices that you did affected those babies, and now they're sitting in somewhere where they're not supposed to be sitting, right? Because of the mother, not because of the child. Come on now. So we got to understand the voices that we want to be that voice. And I wish I maybe there was somebody that voice, but he wasn't paying attention. But you maybe Oski gets tired of me telling him over and over and over. Maybe he gets tired, and he was like what do you call it when you like not mock somebody, but you like he was doing that to his mom, and he looked like his mom when he was doing that. What is it called?
Imitating.
imitating. He was imitating his mom. Oscar, you got to get things right, Oscar. And if you don't eat your food, Oscar, you're not going to get dessert, Oscar. And he was going on and on, and he really looked like his mom. But see that voice that keeps saying over and over, you got to get it together, Oscar. You got to get it together, Susan.
Yeah.
You got to get it together, Daisy.
Yeah.
You got to get it together, Alexis. You got to get it together, Cindy. Come on,
yeah.
Over and over, and God's telling us we've got to get it together because we live in the last days.
Yeah.
And that voice, you get tired of hearing that voice and you don't want to hear that voice, right? Sometimes you get tired of hearing it and you want to, and they do plug their ears,
yeah.
I've seen them.
Yeah.
Maybe not the little boy in the corner over here on the right, but I've seen it done. I've seen them really literally plug their ears because they don't want to hear their voice. They're tired of hearing that voice over and over. And John the Baptist day, he lived in the wilderness. He didn't have a good house and all this other stuff. He ate locusts and he, you know, he was like a, kind of like a, I don't know, like a wild man. Yeah. But he wanted to do what God called him to do. And he wanted his voice to be known. And when they would wake up, they would hear the voice. And when they go to sleep, they would hear the voice. And when they pass by the you know, when he baptized the people, because he was getting disciples. Come on.
Yeah.
He was getting disciples, and his disciples were helping him out. He wasn't just him anymore. He was multiplying with his disciples, and he was telling them. So that voice, John the Baptist's voice was so unique. John the Baptist's voice was so so distinct that they could know him anywhere. And it cringed the king, and it cringed because he was living in sin. He had his brother's wife.
Mm-hmm.
And he didn't want to hear what he had to say. And sometimes we don't want to hear what God has to say. And sometimes we don't want to hear about tithe and offering. Sometimes we don't want to hear about excuses. That's all they preach on is excuses. That's all they preach on is growing up. I don't want to grow up. I want to stay the same. Then stay the same. And have all the excuses you want. But I want to grow up. I want to get somewhere. I want to be that witness. I want to be that voice in the wilderness telling people that how God, and this young man, his mom will never be the same. He'll never be the same. He'll never get out of prison. He was convicted of murder. And it just blew my mind when I read that story and I seen that story. And it's still, even till this day, that's why I say, and I always forget his name, you know. I say Hernandez, but I said something else. But that story just cringes because I wonder if somebody was told him about the Lord Jesus Christ. I wonder if he really would have gave his life to Jesus Christ, the outcome would have been so different. The outcome. The devil snuffed his life. Don't you understand? He will be behind bars for the rest of his life. You should be sorry in your spirit. You should say, God, let not another young man or a young woman be on my watch, go to jail or to prison. Come on now. Let me reach these kids that are sitting in these seats, because I am tired of these kids sitting in the seats and they grow up and they never come back and they're all messed up or jacked up. But they could never say that I didn't preach to them. They could never say that pastor didn't preach to them. Can they say that can they say that about you?
Right.
Can they say when they're sleeping, can they hear your voice?
Amen.
Can they hear the voice of the preacher? Can they hear the voice of the mom? Can they hear the voice of the dad? Can they hear the voice of the person that, you know, loves God with all their heart? Let's be that voice, that uncompromised voice. Like, let's not say nothing. The devil has our mouth shut up. And we don't need to be shut up at this time. We need our voices to be heard. We need to tell them that Jesus is coming back soon. We need to show them signs and wonders. We need to be that witness. We need to tell others about the love of God. We need to warn them. Jeremiah had a voice and he preached for 70 years. And nobody got saved. But he kept on preaching one day. And one day went from a month. And then from that month went from a year. For 70 years he preached.
Yeah. Yeah.
Isaiah was another one. He preached and he tore them up from the floor up. Isaiah, Elisha, all of them were preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ preached and he tore them up, and they didn't want to hear it. They wanted to stone him. They wanted to put him up. They wanted to shut him up. They wanted to kill him until they killed him and said, finally, at last, he died.
Yeah.
But his disciples didn't shut up.
Yeah.
Maybe some of them were shooken up because one of them denied him 3 times. But after that, they said, all right, we're on it.
Yeah.
And they were that voice. And they were saying, I thought Jesus died. Why is this guy still preaching about Jesus? Jesus is dead. Because Jesus is not dead. They wanted to be that voice. And we need to be that voice. Just like that voice show. That's, you know, and they're looking for that. God is looking for that one. God is looking for that unique one. That one that's uncompromised. The one that's going to be faithful. The one that's going to be committed. The one that's going to be sold out. Come on now. The one that's going to preach the word. You really want me to tell them to repent? You really want me to call them vipers, snakes, and devils? You really want me to tell them to get right and to live a holy life? You really, you know, we have to count the cost. Because sometimes you won't have a lot of followers when you're preaching the truth. Sometimes you'll have just have a handful. Sometimes you get the, there she, I hear her, you know. And Pastor Vince goes, we go to Walmart, and all he has to do is stop and see where I'm at, and he could hear me from miles away. There she is, I hear her voice. There she is, I hear her voice. See, in this young man, he didn't hear the voice of God.
Yeah.
He heard the voice of the enemy. And maybe he did, but he's like, nah, I got time.
Yeah.
I got 40 million. I mean, I'm going to go party. I'm going to go do this. I'm going to go do that. And all that, and it caught up to him.
Yeah.
And it's so sad. Because he sits in prison today for the rest of his life without parole. He will never, ever, ever be able to get out of those four walls, out of that fence with the barbed wire. He'll always have to eat prison food for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
The next one I want to talk about, my son was talking to me about this today. I don't really know much about the thing, but it happened here in our city, and I don't know if you know that. This young lady's missing. And you know, it's we go over the 4th Street Bridge and it's there and it's like, but it's not our kid.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's not our grandkid. It's not our neighbor, you know, it's not nobody that we knew. But this young lady was from Denver and she had a boyfriend that lived here, right,
yeah.
Trish?
Yeah.
And he's still here?
Yeah.
And he still plays basketball.
Mm-hmm.
And this young lady's nowhere to be found. And if you go on tonight or whenever this week, watch 2020. Is it on the internet?
Xfinity
on demand. There's a show, 2020, on Kelsey Schilling's. And this young lady, this is a family of a young woman who went missing 3 months ago. And this was 3 years ago, saying she was pregnant at the time of her disappearance, and renewed their plea for help in finding her. And the mother will not stop.
Right.
The mother's voice will not stop until she finds her baby.
Yeah.
The mother's voice will not stop on 2020 now.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this was just recently?
Yeah.
2 days ago. She will not stop. Her voice will be heard until her baby's found, or the bones of her baby, or the her daughter, her body will be found. But she will not stop. She will keep on with her voice, and she will cry, and she will tell everybody her story about her 22-year-old daughter that went missing here in Pueblo, Colorado, and was at her car was at the Southside Walmart, right up the street where you guys live, right up the street where I live. Where I went yesterday, that her car was there, nowhere to be found.
Yeah.
We need to pray for this mother. We need to pray that closure would come to this mother. Because I was sitting there thinking, what would I do if I did? You know, your death is, you see the body, you see the, you bury them, you know. You know, but missing, you don't know where they're at. You don't know where they're, you know, what happened. And you go over in your mind and you're thinking, what happened to my daughter? She was 22. And, you know, the voice of that mother, and see, it's a different story. You know, he made a wrong choice. This mother, you know, her voice will be heard until she finds her baby,
right,
until her baby is found. And it's really, really sad. I haven't watched the 2020, which I will watch, but if you go on there, you'll know. And it said, Kelsey Schellings, 22, was 8 weeks pregnant when she vanished. Her family said Monday, "We love and miss Chelsea so much." Schellings said, and are more deeply saddened to know that whatever happened to her that night also involved her unborn child, my first grandbaby as well.
Yeah.
Wow.
she just went. Nobody knows where she's at.
That's right.
Nobody knows. But that mother's voice will be heard. And it was heard again 2 days ago. And if you go over the 4th Street Bridge, that she always has billboards, and they cost a lot. How much?
$5,000.
$500. We looked into that to put our New Hope sign in there. And maybe it will be there on one day. But the $500 for that lady to have her baby's picture up there, and her voice will be heard until the day she finds out what happened to her child.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So we got to understand that our voice needs to be heard in these last days. What happened to her? Why did she come from Denver to Pueblo? Where did she go? Her car was there. Where is she at? Nobody knows. And nobody's been arrested ever, and not even with that either. But we have to understand that we have to be that voice to these young ladies to stay away from bad guys, to stay away, to choose life and not death, to make right choices. We gotta be that voice that instills in them, stay in your education, do what's right, go to church even though you don't wanna go. Be that example, amen?
Yeah.
We got to do that. And the Bible says that, it says, "This day I call heaven and earth as a witness against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. Now choose life." And God's voice could be so ever heard. He wants his children. You are his children. I am his children. Those people that are sitting in the bars, children. Those people that are hearing us right now in their yards, that's God's children. God wants them to choose life and not death. God wants them to be saved. God wants them to be set free, to be delivered. God wants them are his children, and his voice would be ever so heard. But sometimes we snuff the voice of God, and we can't do that. Sometimes we do that because we don't want to hear it. We want to do what we want to do. We want to party like it's 2016, and we're going to be all right. And they keep saying Jesus is coming back soon, but he hasn't came back yet, so I'm all right. Come on now. I want to be that voice that tells the young people. I want to be that voice that tells the body of Christ to wake up. Jesus is coming back soon. God is coming for a bride without spot or wrinkle. He's coming. I want to be that voice. Do you? Do you want to be that voice that's in your kids' ear that you better get right? You don't want to go to hell. You want to go to heaven. Jesus is coming back soon. Amen. Choose life. Stick around with the right crowd. My kids, over and over and over, Oscar, I would tell them over and over, stick around with the wrong crowd, you're going to get yourself in trouble.
Yeah.
Stick around with the right crowd, and you're going to be all right.
Yeah.
Because good morals, bad company corrupts good morals.
That's right.
Come on now.
That's right.
Just like the apples are all together, and they stay together for, it don't matter, potatoes or whatever, and one gets rotten, the other one's going to get rotten sooner or later.
Yeah.
Sooner or later, that one's going to get rotten. Why? Because they're sticking around. They're with the rotten, wrong person.
Yeah.
And we have to tell them. We have to be that voice. That voice that tells them, you know what? You know, you need to be on the right path. You need to be on that narrow path. And God said for us to choose life and not death. And it said, God said, now choose life so that you and your children may live and that you may love the Lord your God and listen to his voice.
Amen.
Listen to God's voice.
Amen.
And you said, I say, well, I can't hear God's voice. I can't hear God's voice. Put the dog on there. Do you got the picture of the dog? Oh, you had to get that one. Oh, Dad, and you're going to get all happy. We'll cut you out a picture, babe. And you can have that picture of a dog. It's a boxer. We're looking at dogs for a reason and a purpose, Oscar. How many know that? Dogs know their master's voice. Dogs know their master's voice. They say, you lost your dog, you go to the dog pound. They say, oh, well, that's my dog right there. And you're like, huh. The guy's like, I'll see if that's your dog or not. You know, $1,000 dog, $500 dog or whatever. And then they go, come here, Spotty. And he just sits there and just looks at you. His name's not Spotty, his name's John.
John.
Oh, okay, that's a human name, sorry. His name is, his name is, what's that, what's Malaya's dog's name? Sugars! Sugars! My dog's name is Sugars, Grum. Sugars! And I'm like, what? What's your dog's name? Sugars. And I'm like, what? Sugars. I'm like, wow.
Wow.
And what's the other name?
Chica. Bailey.
Bailey. Yeah, she never remembers that one, but she remembers Sugars. My dog's name is Sugars, Grum. And I'm like, all right, your name is... So we named this dog Sugar. So, but how many know that your dog knows your master?
Yeah. Amen.
He knows his voice. Yeah. And we have to know the voice of God.
Amen.
Just like the dogs. And they're not even humans. Come on now.
Yeah.
They're so cute and they're so kind and never mind. They're just cute right there, but they have make a big mess and they're not no good after that. They're like kids. We don't need no more kids. We got a bunch of grandkids. Oh, chihuahuas. Right? So we need to know that dog knows his master's voice. That dog knows his master. That dog knows when they're calling him, and he runs and he licks them and all over his face. And where have you been? You left me. He probably thinks, but really, the dog's left the master, right? Let me go to the scripture. John chapter 10. Go there. Verse 14. Chelsea was 22 and Aaron was 20. I think he was in his 20s, I'm not sure. 26 years old. John chapter 10, verse 14. Mine's not coming up. Come and read it. You got the King James Version? New King James? He's got... Okay, come here.
I am the good shepherd and I know my sheep and I am known by my own.
Keep going.
Oh, okay. As the Father knows me, even so I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have which are not of this fold. Them also I must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore my Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. Therefore, there was a division again among the Jews because of...
Thank you. The voice. Good. Very good, reader. The voice. Did you get that on there? The voice.
Yes.
Whoever does not welcome me...
Did I say that right?
I am the good shepherd, and I know without any doubt those who are my own, and my own know me, and I have a deep personal relationship with that have a deep personal relationship with me. Even as my Father knows me, I know the Father. I lay down my very own life, sacrificing it for the benefit of the sheep. He laid his life down for you. Verse 16, I have other sheep besides these that are not of this fold. I must bring those also, and they will listen to my voice and pay attention to my call. Come on now. And they will become one flock with me. You got to listen to God's voice. You got to listen to God's voice. Amen?
Amen.
God knows. We have to know God's voice. How do you listen to the voice of God's Spirit? What does God's voice sound like? If you are going to make a right decision, you need to be able to follow the right voice. You got a pair of shoes up there? Let me see what she picked out. She has a good taste. Let's see if she did a Jordan. Oh, she's got some nice ones. Well, there they are. Come on now. How do you listen to God's voice, God's Spirit? What does God's voice sound like? If you are going to make a right decision, you need to be able to follow the right voice. Here are a pair of shoes, or a lot of pair of shoes. A shoe is often used to represent following somebody. Come on now. How can you follow the right voice? Come on, you see? Amen. When you are faced with a temptation, you may hear many voices. Don't listen to your parents. Don't listen to your pastor. All he tells you is, come to church, pray. Don't listen to that. Come on now. Don't listen to your parents. They're trying to spoil all your fun. Come on now. Or whoever's over you. Because you got that one, young people. And I know that you guys got your auntie. And sometimes Auntie Angela, na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na. Come on now. And na-na-na-na, there's Auntie Angela, let's run. She's going to ask us to go to church again. We don't want to go. Come on now. Isn't that right?
Yeah.
There she goes again, telling us about the Lord. Come on now. You may hear a lot of voices. And sometimes we don't want to hear those right voices. You may hear many voices in your mind. You may hear the voice of Satan trying to get you to give in to the temptation. Come on now.
Yeah.
Or for you to listen to him. Don't listen to them. There was one young lady here 3 weeks ago that said that the devil was speaking to her. Don't listen to that man. Don't listen to that man's voice. Don't listen to Pastor. That's what she was talking about. Pastor Vince, don't listen to him. Don't listen. And sitting in the service. Yeah. So don't tell me that the devil's not telling you guys anything. Yeah. Or you guys, not this church. The devil doesn't sit here. He doesn't listen. You know, he's not in my mind. Come on now. Sometimes the devil's voice is louder than God's voice.
Amen.
Come on now. You need to listen to God's voice. And God's voice is telling you, I don't know what God's voice is telling you. Obey, be faithful, be committed, give your life to Jesus. Make right choices as they go to school. I don't want to be like Aaron Hernandez.
Yep.
Come on now. I want to do what's right. Come on now.
Amen.
You may hear the voice of Satan trying to get you to give in into temptation, or you are making a tough decision. You may hear the voice in your mind trying to get you to make the wrong decision. Come on, yeah. Wrong decisions. Come on, it doesn't have to just be necessarily for these kids. It could be for us adults. Yeah. Who am I going to marry? Oh, but he's so cute. Oh, but he's so handsome. Yeah. Oh, he carries his Bible. So what? Satan probably carries the Word of God, knows more of the Word of God than him. Come on now. Come on now. We have to make a tough decision. Our job, our finances. Come on now. Who are you going to spend the rest of your life with? Come on now. You may hear his voice in your mind trying to get you to make the wrong decision. Then there are your own thoughts. In Proverbs, God says the ways we usually think are right leads to death. We think up here in our minds and we think we're right and we're not. Come on now. So we don't want to just follow our own thoughts. There are also the ideas of family and friends. Come on now. So we need to make sure that we know God's voice. We need to make sure that we read God's voice. If you don't understand, how many know that when you're confused, that's of the devil?
Yeah.
When you have a confusion in your heart and your mind, that's Satan right away.
Yeah.
When you're like, oh, I don't know, that's the devil.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
God is not the author of confusion. Amen?
Right.
He is not the author of confusion. And let me go back to the dog. How many of you have a dog that comes when he calls you? Hey, you? How about your cat? Does she come to you?
Yeah.
She does. She knows your voice.
Cats don't come.
Diesel goes to you? That's Diego's dog. Diesel goes to you?
Oh,
okay. Diesel goes to him. But when's the last time you seen Diesel?
I've seen a boxer before.
Gina, what do you tell your dogs? Get down, boy. Let me get this on video right here. What do you tell your dogs and your dog's boy? You're the voice, and your dogs obey you.
Tell them to go downstairs with Nana or they're going to go outside.
And what do they do?
They go downstairs.
Okay, tell me the first part, though.
They don't do what I tell them, they're going to hit them.
Wow, and they listen to you. They run away. They obey. We know. We see those dogs sometimes on Wednesdays for women's. And one of them looks like Benji. You ever seen Benji? Google it, Benji, and watch the show. It's pretty good. I told Naomi to watch it. She hasn't yet, probably. I don't know about that, Ask, if Diesel listens to you or not, but hey.
He doesn't.
He doesn't. Okay, and this one knows? Okay, who else has a dog? Anybody else have a dog? Oh, you have a dog? What is your dog? What do you tell your dog? Because I know my father-in-law's dog, when he had him, he prayed? No, spoke Spanish and all that.
My dog, he knows how to say, I love you.
Wow, your dog, I gotta get that on video.
And when I leave him, when I go to work, I lock him in the kennel. Sometimes he gets out, he knows how to open the kennel. And then sometimes he gets in the trash, and so as soon as I come inside, I know that he's done something because he's still in the kennel. And when I walk up the stairs, I'm like, you are in big trouble, Oriole. And then he just hides in the corner of his kennel, and he doesn't get out of the kennel because he knows. And then once I pick up the trash, and then I tell him, get out. And he goes running downstairs, and he starts jumping up and down to get outside because he knows he's going to get it. So as soon as he gets out, he gets whacked with the broom.
So Oreo gets into the trash.
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
But he knows your voice.
Yeah.
Get downstairs with Nana, and they run down there, huh? Wow. Come on now. Anybody else have a dog? Oh, what does your dog do?
Sarah. And she got into my mom's truck, and I was like, you know you're getting in big trouble. And she looks at me, and she runs out.
She got into what?
She got into my mom's truck, and I was all like, you're in big trouble. And she was eating my mom's lip gloss.
She was eating lip gloss. She wanted lip gloss. She wanted to look fancy. She wanted some lipsticks. She was going to meet
her date. She wanted fancy teeth. She wanted pink teeth.
When somebody loses a dog and it comes to reclaim it at the pound, do you know one of the ways they can tell if a person is actually the dog's owner? They see if the dog knows the person's voice. A dog will always recognize the voice of his owner, and I'm not calling anybody dogs here tonight. Jesus did that in the Bible. I didn't. Amen, right? It says, a dog will always recognize the voice of his owner because he has spent so much time. Come on now. Because he has spent so much time with that owner, listening to his or her voice. Come on now. In the same way, we need to learn God's voice and God's spirit, because we need to take time to spend time with God. In the scriptures reading, prayer, come on. We need to spend time. Only as we spend a lot of time with God, we will recognize his voice. And that's found in John chapter 10, and we just read it. Jesus compares his people to the sheep, saying, I know my sheep, and they know me. And sheep will never follow a stranger, but run away from him because they do not recognize his voice or the stranger's voice. Come on now. If you are one of God's children, come on. If you are ready for his coming, you will follow God's voice. Just like that dog and his owner, you need to learn his voice by spending time with him each day in the scripture and in prayer. You need to know God's voice in this last day. You have to recognize God's voice. God will always speak to you if you're listening. And sometimes we don't listen. Sometimes we don't listen. We listen to strangers. We listen to people, like it said in here. We listen to family members. We listen to children. We listen to everybody else. We listen to our, you know, everybody else except God. We need to spend time with God. We need to be, and once you spend time with God, and once you know God's voice, then you're going to start getting your voice, and your voice is going to be God's voice. God speaking, the word of God's going to go forth, and you're going to be able to preach, you're going to be able to teach, you're going to be able to tell people, you're going to be able to save other Aaron Hernandez's, you're going to be able to save other Chelsea's, you're going to be able to save all those people that are sitting in the county jail right now. You're going to be able to save them. You're going to be able to save the kids that are sitting right next to you, to the babies that are sitting right next to you. How many know that a mother knows the voice of their child? Yeah. The mother knows, oh, is that Lexi crying? Is that JJ crying? Or oh no, that's not JJ. That's Ruthus crying. And they know.
Yeah.
They know. Okay. I know. But I want to know God's voice. I want to hear God's voice. And I want my voice to be heard throughout this city. I want my voice to be known that, you know what? That Jesus is coming back soon. That we're going to preach the gospel. That we're going to tell people about him. That we're going to know God's voice. We're not going to know just, let me tell you, you know, about, I know of God. No, you're going to know God. You know, let me pray for you. No, you're going to know the power of prayer, because when I pray for you, devils are going to come out. Because when I pray for you, you're going to speak in tongues. Just like Pastor Ben said, the signs and wonders will follow those Because why? Because you spent time with God. Why? Because you know God's voice. Yeah. You're not going to be like, oh, well, I don't know what to do. I don't know. If you don't know what to do, then don't do nothing until you get into that Bible, yeah. Until you know God's voice, until you. And God said he knows you. And does he know you? Does God know you today? Because we say we know God, but does God know us? Does God know our voice? Oh, well, I haven't heard that voice in a long old time. Yeah. What do they need now? Yeah. You know, what do they want now?
Yeah.
I'm Santa Claus today, huh? I'm the vending machine. Oh, I need prayer, Lord. I need you to help me answer this question that I have. Come on now.
Yeah.
And God's like, oh, I haven't heard that voice in a long old time.
Right.
You haven't been praying? You haven't been reading?
Yeah.
Come on now, and we send our kids, we send you kids to school. You guys got to know God's voice. You guys got to know the right voice and the wrong voice. If your friends tell you, hey, let's go start something on fire, you know that's the wrong voice to listen to. Let's go ditch, let's go do this, let's go do that. You know, all anything bad, you know that's not the right voice.
Yeah, amen.
That's the wrong voice.
Right.
And in the back of your mind, I pray that the Holy Spirit, would you would hear our voices, you would hear your parents' voices if they're Christians, and they're filled with the Holy Spirit, and what would my mom's voice say right now? What would her, what would she say? What would Jesus say? What voice? Don't do it. Choose life. Choose life. Choose life. Choose life. But he gives us the choice. He gives. He's such a good God that he said, go this way or that way. I want you to take the right way, but hey, it's up to you. I can't make you. I can't force you because I'm not a God that makes people or forces people. So right. Do what you want. But I'm telling you, choose this way. This way is the best way. It might be bumpy at times. You might not have, you know, all the money in the world, and you might not have all the things that you want, but it's the right way. It's the right way. You have the peace of God. You have everlasting life if you should die at any moment.
Yeah.
You go straight to the throne of God. You go straight to heaven.
Amen.
Come on now.
Amen.
So God's voice, and we need to be that voice. Let's be that voice for that mother. Let's not forget about this young lady. Let's pray that God would, I don't know if this mother knows God. I don't know. But all I know is that her daughter is lost out there somewhere. I don't know where she's at or what happened to her. It's been a long time, but let's pray for this mother that if she doesn't know God, that she would know God. Let's pray like if it's our own daughter. Because how many know if I would have lost Naomi and never found her, I would my voice would have been heard all over the whole world. So we need to pray for that mother. We need to pray for Aaron too. We need to pray for that young man, his soul, that he would be saved. Even though he's not going to get out of prison, he's going to be there for the rest of his life. Until the day he's so old that he dies. And we want to pray for his salvation, that he would make heaven his home. And the people in our city, that they would know our voices. Oh, there's that preacher. There's that church lady again. 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 I hear her voice. Here she comes with some bread. Come on now. But that voice. Come on now. I want to be known for that. I don't want to be known for anything else but that I preached the gospel of Jesus Christ and I loved God with all my heart. And that, you know, people get the choice is up to them. But I can't. If God can't make you,
right,
then I can't make you.
Right.
All I could do was be like John the Baptist, that voice in the wilderness, that voice in the city of Pueblo, that voice on 4th Street, that voice over there on Highway 50, that voice at Walmart, that voice, that because the Mother God people here, they have that voice.
Yeah, right.
Why can't New Hope Ministries have that voice?
Amen.
Oh, what church you go to? New Hope Ministries? Yeah, go to, here's a flyer, come to church sometime.
Right.
If you need a ride, I'll give you a ride. Here's my number.
Yeah.
That voice, that voice. Amen?
Amen.
Pastor Vince.
Amen. I just want to tell you this real quick in 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse number 4. It said, when the Lord called Samuel and he answered, here am I, he ran to Eli and he said, here I am, for you called me. And Eli said to him, I did not call you. Lie down again. So he went and he lied down. And it goes three times that the Lord called him, but the voice he heard was his pastor's voice.
Yeah.
You with me? You say, well, how do I hear the voice of God? Well, he preaches to you every Sunday, every Sunday night, every Monday night, every Wednesday night, every Thursday night, every Friday night, sometimes on Saturdays, and your voice, you with me? My wife's voice just went. That's the voice of the Lord preaching to you. And I've had people tell me, man, I heard your voice say this, I heard you say that, and all that. And that's, you know what I mean? That's the voice of the Lord. You with me? And sometimes your parents are the voice of the Lord, and sometimes they're not, because they might tell you to do wrong. You know what I mean? And so, you know what I mean? You got to know who is from the Lord and who's telling you the right things. You know what I mean? But Samuel and all that, he was a little boy and he heard the voice of God. But it was his pastor's voice that he used. Amen. And so remember that. If your parents are Christians, or your auntie or your grandma, you know, pray that, you know, I pray that you're going to hear their voice. And they're going to speak, and you're going to make right choices. But I wanted to say this, that Aaron Hernandez, you know what I mean, didn't make a decision to be bad when he grew up and he was playing football. Yeah. Aaron Hernandez made a choice to do wrong when he was a little boy. And you guys that are here, and that's why I believe that the Lord said that he wanted to touch you guys that are here, the young ones, 8 years old, 9 years old, 10 years old, 11 years old, because your wrong choices, parents, they're not going to choose in high school to be bad and to do wrong and to listen to the wrong voice. Your kids are already making a choice right now, and you know that. Stephen Hill was the evangelist who started the Brownsville Revival in Pensacola Revival in Florida. And Stephen Hill, he died. He since went on to be with the Lord. But Stephen Hill said, I was a drug addict. I was in the streets. I was selling. I was in prison. All this bad stuff had happened. And he said, you know that it didn't happen when I was old. You know when it happened? He said, it happened on one day, and I know the day. He said that I went into the kitchen and my mother had just baked fresh baked chocolate chip cookies. And she told me, she said, Stephen, don't touch them cookies, they're for after dinner. You're going to eat your dinner, you know what I mean? And don't touch those cookies. And he said, Mom went out of the kitchen. And he said, the moment I seen she was gone, I reached and I grabbed me them cookies and I took off. And I went and ate those cookies. He said, but when I did that, something entered me. He said, an evil spirit entered my life. And he said, and from that point on, I was disobedient to my mother and my father. And he said, and I ended up a drug addict. I ended up living in the streets. I ended up finally in prison and people trying to kill him and all this stuff. And he said, it was the day I stole them cookies from my mom when she told me, you know, see, disobedience to the Lord don't start when you get in high school. And when you meet friends that get high and they do drugs and they drink and they ditch. It doesn't happen then. It happens right now to you in church. Because see, let me tell you this, we got kids in our church today that are 18, 19, 20 and older, you with me? That are out there, and some of you know who they are, and they're living in drugs, alcohol, disobedient lives, and you say, well, geez, they just turned bad when they were old. No, it didn't happen when they were old. It happened when they were young. And you know that some of them even say that they hate our church because we were mean to them. You with me? And let me tell you something. We were never mean to any of them. What we did was tell them the truth.
That's right.
And they don't want to hear the truth.
Right.
They didn't want to hear that. They wanted to mess around. They got mad when they were in Royal Rangers. They got mad when they were in Mission Nets. They made choices. They got bitter in their hearts towards the church and towards God because they did not want to obey.
Right.
And today, they're paying for it.
Yeah, that's right.
You with me?
Yep.
And some even that age have died.
Yeah.
Some are in prison today.
Yeah.
You with me? Yeah. Some have went out of prison. Some, you know what I mean? They're living their lives, but they're still disobedient to God.
Right.
And the only way for you youth, young people that are here to get right and stay on the right track is to get the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Parents, your children need the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Stop playing games. Stop playing this and on the phones and all this other stuff. Get into the Word of God and start training your children in the ways of the Lord.
Yeah.
Start teaching them in the ways they should go.
Right.
You're not going to teach them anywhere. You know what I mean? Teach them. You need to pray in tongues. You need the Holy Spirit because you're sending them into a world like lambs among wolves, man. And the only way that they're going to make it is with the Holy Spirit inside of them. Some of the choices you're making right now, guys, that you're 10, you're 9, you're 8 years old, some of you are already you may not even know it. You're already on a road to destruction.
Yep. Right.
And the only way to help you and the only way to save your life is to give your life to Jesus and to receive the Holy Spirit.
Right.
Or you can end up like Aaron Hernandez.
Yep.
Sitting in prison. And let me tell you, Pastor Susan, there is hope for him, though.
Yeah, there is.
Because he may not have to spend the rest of his life in prison if he gets saved.
That's right.
Because God has a way of turning things around for you when you serve him and when you live for him. He'll get you out of jail. He'll get you out of prison. But why even go there? Why even want to go there? Why want to go to PYC? Why want to get in trouble? Or more than anything else, understand, kids, you guys, just as us old guys are apt to die anytime.
Yep.
Right.
What if you died today?
Right.
Would you go to heaven?
Right.
Well, I hope so. No, there's not no hope so. Either you know so or you're not going.
Right.
And the only way to go to heaven is repenting of your sins.
Right.
That means asking God to forgive you for doing wrong and not doing it again.
Right.
Turning to Jesus with all your hearts. But I really felt tonight that God said he wanted to fill these kids with the Holy Ghost. Because you need him. Guys, coming to church ain't going to do you no good if you don't have the Holy Spirit in your life. Got parents, your kids, I don't care how long they can be raised in church and they don't get the Holy Ghost and they don't start living for the Lord now, not then, now. They're not going to make it. I don't care what you say. They're not going to make it.
Right.
We need to be aggressive with our children and be that voice and speaking to them. You know what I mean? And teaching them by example.
Right.
You with me? Leading them in the ways that they should go. That they hear your voice when they're going to make a wrong decision. Yes. They hear that, not a voice. I'm going to beat you, boy. I'm going to slap you. I'm going to do this. But, you know, son, come this way. Daughter, come this way. Don't go with a stranger.
Yeah.
You with me?
Right.
They've got to hear the voice. If they're not going to hear it from you, they're going to hear it from their pastor.
Yep.
If you won't tell them, I will tell them.
Yep.
If you won't lead them, we'll try here at New Hope to try and lead them to the things of God. Our Royal Rangers teachers, our Missionette teachers, we'll try and teach them and lead them. But we can't make them if you're not doing it at home.
Right.
We only got them an hour or two, you know what I mean, for the week, Thursday night. We can't make your children serve the Lord. We can't tell them. You know what I mean? Hopefully, maybe they heard something tonight where they'll get saved and receive the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
But you're the parents. You're the ones that take them home and go live with them. And you can't just ignore them and let them go watch TV and the internet and games and go about your life busy, busy, busy. And you're letting your kids go to hell.
Right.
Come on, somebody. I know you don't like it, but it's the truth.
Right.
You with me? If you don't invest in them and you don't teach them and you don't train them and you don't disciple them, I guarantee you right now, not in middle school, right now in elementary school, there's people discipling them right now. And they're teaching them and they're training them, and that's why they're ending up in principal's offices and stuff, and it's already happening. It's not going to happen. It's already done happened a while back.
Right.
And the only way to get them back, or the only way for you young kids, because you've already made your decisions.
Yep.
And tonight you're going one way and you've been doing wrong, you've been doing bad, you've been disobedient. The only way for you to get saved is to turn around and to say, you know what, I want to serve the Lord.
Right.
Just like these adults that are here, you two need to turn to Jesus tonight. And God will fill you with his Holy Spirit. God will strengthen you. God will help you. My wife said it. Pastor Susan said it. She said it to you parents. She said, listen, choose life. Choose life. Don't go the wrong way. She says, so you and your children will receive an inheritance, so you don't be condemned.
Right.
Gee, you mean my decisions and what I'm doing today are going to affect all my babies?
Yep.
You better believe it.
Yep.
The decisions and the lifestyle you're making right now is going to take your children to heaven or to hell.
Right.
The decisions you make today.
Right.
You with me?
Yes.
That's why it's important that we choose to serve the Lord. Amen, Pastor.
Amen.
That we choose to serve the Lord so our children have a hope and a future. You with me?
Yes.
We were nobodies, man. We were 18 and 19, got saved. And we had to take our little two daughters, and then a third with Amber, and then my son came along, and then Naomi came along, and they were all little, and we raised them in church. But we were proactive in their lives. And whether they chose to serve the Lord or not is their choice. But we did our best to raise our children in the things of God. And we didn't leave church over there at 1010 Troy or 801 West 4th Street where Church on the Rock was. Our church was in our house. And we had services, and we taught our children. And listen, you can't make them serve God, though.
That's right.
They have their own choice and their own free will.
That's right, amen.
Just like you kids that are here tonight, you have your own choice and your own free will. Pay attention to me.
Amen. Amen.
Every one of you got your own free will.
Amen.
You don't have to come up here for prayer, and you don't have to serve the Lord. But I'm telling you, one day you may end up in a place, not just prison. This little girl is missing. And how many of you want to make a bet that chances are that probably 99% of the fact is that she's probably dead somewhere?
Yeah.
We hope and we pray she's not. But missing for so long, what are the odds? What are the chances? Come on, don't look at me like that. I know we don't want to hear that. But what are the chances that she's alive today?
Right.
If she was, I guarantee she would have ran to her mother.
Yeah.
She would have ran to somebody. She would have ran home.
Yeah.
What if you young little girls that are here today, what if you one day met a guy and you ended up going and living, taking off with him, and then you ended up dead somewhere?
Right.
Do you know how many people that we know, even from this church, that ended up dead? One girl from the home ended up going back to New Mexico, and Pastor Ray and Pastor Ed pleaded and begged, don't leave the home, please, Ita. God's working on your life. And she said, I know what I'm doing. I need to go home. And that was the last they seen of her. When we were in New Mexico, in Albuquerque, they said, this is a girl from our church. They just found her out in the desert, chopped up in pieces, and she's been murdered.
Yeah. Oh my God.
How many think she should have stood in the home?
Yeah.
She stood where the presence of God was, where God is moving,
yeah.
Where God could have used her.
Yes.
But she made a choice to go off and do her own thing because she thought she knew best.
Yeah.
You with me? And I know sometimes we think we know best, but there's a way that seems right unto a man, but the end thereof is destruction and hellfire, and the devil don't want you to believe that.
Right,
he wants you to believe you're just going to die and maybe God will have mercy and this and that. No, you must repent of your sin. You must turn to the Lord tonight. You must ask Him, God, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Fill me with your presence. I can't make it without you, God. I need the Holy Ghost. How many of you understand people get demon-possessed?
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
So if there's devils that can possess your life and control you, how many know that there's a Holy Ghost,
yeah.
The Holy Spirit of God that can possess your life and help you in life and bless you and make you and help you to make right decisions?
Yeah.
I know it's not easy. It's not easy for any of us.
Yeah.
But it's a decision that we have to make. Say, you know what? I want to serve you. God, help me serve you, Lord.
Right.
I want to do it. So stand with me tonight.
Yes.